So David Martens is starting to work his way around the inverted flap techniques with a beautiful described techniques. David Martens, please.
Thank you very much. But my presentation will be with a video and with the several cases and a different way to perform the inverted flap technique.
Just press the button, please.
Idiopathic full-thickness macular hole is an anatomic defect in the fovea featuring interruption of all neuroretinal layers from the ILM to the RPE. Several surgical techniques have been suggested towards a better anatomic success, namely vitrectomy with complete peeling or with inverted flap of the internal limiting membrane. To stain the ILM, we use brilliant blue G. We decided to treat this patient with a medium-sized full-thickness macular hole with 23G vitrectomy, complete ILM peeling, and SF6 tamponade. The second case is of a macular hole that had already been surgically treated unsuccessfully. In these clinical situations, with previous complete ILM removal, several solutions were reported, like the temporal arched incision, radial incisions, or the ILM graft. Our choice in this case was to try the ILM graft. We peeled a segment of the ILM near the inferior temporal arcade over the macular hole. As we can see, it was very difficult to introduce the ILM graft over the hole. A bubble of heavy liquid was injected to facilitate the maneuvers. With time, persistence, and a golf player-like trick, we managed to put the ILM graft over the hole. Finally, we performed fluid hair exchange and SF6 tamponade. In the last three cases, we performed a variation of the inverted ILM flap technique with success. We are performing this alternative technique for large and complex full-thickness macular holes. After core and peripheral vitrectomy, we use, as usual, brilliant blue G to stain the ILM. Then, we outline the superior ILM flap, extending to the border of the macular hole with a triangular shape. After this, we removed the remaining ILM around the fovea as usual. carefully, we peel the triangular-shaped ILEM flap till the superior border of the macular hole, and we cover it. Then we inject heavy liquid to stabilize and keep the inverted ILEM flap in the position until the end of the surgery. The second case is an interesting one, as you will see. We performed the same surgical technique. Look to the hole. It seems a double macular hole. It's interesting. And in this case, we don't see very well the ILEM stained around the fovea. We continued the tissues peeling around the fovea that looked like chewing gum. We think that these tissues are remnants of cortical vitreous around and over the macular hole. After a second staining, now we can see clearly the ILEM in order to proceed with our surgical strategy. We removed the remnants of the vitreous over the macular hole with a cutter. Here, we peel the triangular-shaped ILEM flap till the superior border of the macular hole. Finally, we cover the macular hole with a single-layered internal limiting membrane flap, and the heavy liquid was introduced over the macula to keep the inverted ILEM flap in place. Perfluoroenoctane was removed at the end of the fluid air exchange. In this last case, the patient had a large and long-standing full-thickness macular hole. We used the same surgical technique, but decided to use triamcinolone for a better visualization of the vitreous and the vitreoretinal interface. We performed core and peripheral vitrectomy. We injected a new dye, double dyne, to stain the internal limiting membrane. After a few seconds, we began our alternative inverted flap technique for large macular holes, drawing a triangular-shaped superior temporal flap. Thereafter, we peeled the ILM around the macula and foveum, including the nasal ILM. Because we share the opinion of other authors that tangential traction contributes to macular hole formation, and these forces also exist nasally to the fovea. We must release these tractional forces. Gently, we bended the ILM flap to cover the macular hole and then injected PFCL to maintain the inverted ILM flap stable. We completed peripheral shaving. At the end, we performed fluid air exchange and gas tamponade with SF6 at 25%.
Thank you, David.
Thank you.
Excellent. Thank you. So I suggest we, you know, once we go home, we go and pick up one of those of our kids' little booklet and try different way of sharing, you know, papers and getting much into how to proceed with the island peeling. Alessandro Lavac will talk about another technique, the double inverted flap technique for stage 4 macular holes. I think that he's got a quite interesting presentation. Yes.
Thank you, Ihab. I want to thank the board for the opportunity to be here. During the following minutes, I will comment on the double inverted flap technique for macular hole surgery. The video is not running.
One more time.
Again. This is the other video, okay. And this is the first one.
Hold on.
Nope, it's not working. Anyhow, I can continue without the video. There's two videos, the first one. I can explain it without the video or until it runs. Basically, what we do is to create two vertical flaps, one in the nasal area and the other one in the temporal side. And starting from its edges, we create two flaps to cover the hole from both sides. One flap beneath the other one. Of course, it's better if we can see the video, but
No, no, it will not.
Okay, we can continue.
Was it a PowerPoint presentation?
Yes.
Not the foreign.
Okay. These are the result of the surgery. In order to test the surgery, we perform it with creating both flap, but without the fluid and air exchange. We leave the and of course without face down position. We just create the flap and leave it the eye fill of fluid. So in the top of the slide, we can see the day after of the surgery with the hole closure only by the flaps. And we follow this patient week by week with several OCT. And for the days 50, we can see the hole finally close. I want to remember that we didn't use gas or air and no face position, just in order to test the double flap technique. These are the picture of different case. And during the follow-up, we saw several signs of success. The first signs were was the cyst disappearance, as we can see on the top of the slide. After that, we can see how the retinal tissue start to grow beneath the flap, and the finally result is when you can see the ellipsoid restoration in the outer retina. To sum it up, I want to say that the technique is easy to perform. I mean, the two flaps are really easy to create when you make first the vertical cut. Another possible advantage is that you have two flaps instead of one. It does mean that if you lose one flap, you still have the other one covering the hole. And we have the feeling that when you have both flaps, the flaps are more stabilized and there's less chances to lose one of the flaps. And finally, because the two flap creation, you still have a huge area of eyeline peeling in order to address tangential tractions. And this is the end of the presentation.
Thank you, Alejandro. For both of you, have you thought about the effect of gravity of having, I know David, you showed this in the video that you'd go for the triangular superior hinged flap so that, you know, if you sit down, so the flap just by gravity would be held to the side. Maybe Alejandro also, if you have a superior and a temporal, like a trapdoor thing, you know, just, you know, it's a thought about having.
It could be a good idea. What we are doing now in order to get more stabilized flap, we make one flap shorter, and we put covers the hole, and the second flap, the temporal one, typically is larger, and cover the other one, and we have the feeling in that way we don't need the air to stabilize the flaps.
Can this be like a long superior and a short temporal or nasal, so that's superior by the...
I think that it doesn't matter how long you have one shorter and the other one larger. Excellent. Because if both are big, it tend to roll,
exactly.
You know?
Mm-hmm. Excellent. David, yeah, sure.
I think that the superior flap, it's easier to stabilize because I peel and I put in over the hole, and after that, the issue is to inject heavy liquid up in upper side of the retina, the macula, and so the heavy liquid cover the flap and stabilize during the rest of the procedure.
So you're kind of ironing it, right?
Like yes.
Just holding it positions
the up. Point.
Well, we open very much for this discussion. Shingul, please.
Thank you, Ihab. I want to thank to Jerzy for giving us the idea of using ILM to seal a macular hole. Then we are just playing with the ILM now, as I see.
Yeah.
What I do is I use always PFCL to stabilize the inverted flap or free flap. And I usually lose the flap if I don't use the PFCL during fluid air exchange. I want to ask all the ILM inverter presenters
flappers, ILM flappers.
How to stabilize their flap and how to do the how to prevent the dislodgement of the flap during fluid air exchange, because my way is to clear all the BSS around the PFCL before I took the PFCL out, so that you don't have any fluid left which will cause dislodgement of the flap.
Sophia? Mm-hmm. Yeah, go ahead, Sophia.
Okay, so first of all, I never use PFCL. It's a great idea, but I don't do it. I create quite a large flap from the temporal side. I don't trim it now. It was in the original technique from 2010. No, and we trimmed it because we were a little bit afraid that there may be some epirhythmal membrane formation. Now, after many years and many studies, we know that the rest of the ILM does not induce epirhythmal membrane formation, so we are not afraid anymore to leave a bigger part of it. And if you peel a bigger part from the temporal side and remove the fluid above your optic nerve, then you will always push the flap to the direction of the optic nerve. And in this way, you can reduce the chance of losing your flap. And you had another question through the SMS, as I see, what are the parameters in vitrectomy machine during trimming of the ILM flap? And I think the answer was already told that I do not trim anymore.
Thank you. Ivan, please.
I have a question to Didier. Although I am a big advocate of his theory concerning the ischemia of macula stimulating the edema and the reactive gliosis and so on, I know that epirhythmal membrane is a layer of the vitreous cases, but I don't understand one thing. Why in all cases of epimacular membranes, there is posterior vitreous detachment, while in diabetic macular edema or in branch retinal vein occlusion or other kinds of edema, the PVD is not present? Well, in 99.9%.
No. There are a lot of cases without PVD around, let's say, I would say between 2 and 5%. The problem is that you must understand that we are speaking of edema. If there is a plaque of hyaluronic, you speak of epirhythmal membrane. But so this is the same thing.
I call it so-called membrane.
And
okay.
Yes. And if the PVD is not made, there is no contraction, and but this happened. I show yesterday the cases where there is no PVD, and this is the same for diabetic macular edema or post-venous thrombosis macular edema. There are cases with PVD and cases without. You can find both.
Okay, because the previous theory concerning the epirhythmal membrane was just the vitreous contracts for some reason and it lets a thin layer on the macula.
No,
But
no.
Accepting your theory of GFAP and all that stuff,
no,
we don't have the explanation for so frequent PVD.
And once again, we heard this morning people speaking of traction, vitreous macular traction. The traction is not the origin. Traction is the consequence. First, there is the astrocytic proliferation that entered the fibers in the of the hyaluronic, and when the hyaluronic detached, this is a traction. So So we must pay attention not to who is it, the egg or the...
Or the hen.
Yeah.
Yeah.
Huh? I understand, but still...
Yeah, it's a big issue, Ivan. You know, it's like, you're right. Go to the next question, please.
Thank you. Good morning. Abdi Shabavsar, Minneapolis, Minnesota. First, Jerzy, thank you very much for the technique. Second, I never use PFL, but I also only use the technique during those cases that are very large macular holes or traumatic macular holes, and I reserve the remainder to do standard techniques for. My comment is that I think we are fooling ourselves if we believe the flap is going to stay in the place we put it at the end of surgery, because there is always more fluid in the eye. There's always a drop or two or more, and even if we wait 10 minutes after the fluid air exchange, there's a large amount of fluid posteriorly. If we wait 15 minutes, there's still some fluid posteriorly, right? And so even a few drops is all it takes to move that flap. So even though I'm convincing myself at the end of surgery, I go back and I dry the flap again, and there's still a drip of fluid there, and I'm thinking that, okay, I'm hoping that it stays here, but I think I'm probably fooling myself, and I think we probably all are. There probably is some movement, so maybe the solution is not just in the positioning of the flap, but is it just having tissue somewhere nearby. Maybe that's all that really matters. In the last case, we did see some of the tissue, it looked like was lateral to the flap or collateral to the flap, not inside the hole itself. And so what do you think about that?
Yeah, so if you may, where does the fluid come from?
I don't know.
It comes from the vitreous base. So the vitreous base is
you never
there.
Know. Maybe from optic nerve.
Yeah.
Also.
Go ahead, Joseph.
But I agree with you what you said. I never use perfluorocarbon liquid in those cases to secure the flap because it is an additional issue.
Sure.
And actually, I do not see any sense to use it. I use usual technique of fluid air exchange just to control the movement of fluid and controlling the position of flap by the movement of fluid.
Sure.
And I do very careful, maybe 5 minutes fluid air exchange. In some cases, of course, you see very, very tiny amount of fluid, but I do not think it disturbs. If you have the feeling it disturbs, but it happened maybe in 1 or 2% of my cases, I put some viscoelastic under air on the flap to secure the position.
Very good, thank you very much.
Can I take one more question, Ron? I think the fluid comes from the dehydrated collagen in the vitreous. Yeah. So if you leave more vitreous, you'll have more fluid, they have to wait more as well. Yeah. Please, Ron.
Regarding securing the flap, what I do is very similar to what Zosia discussed. The main issue is during the last few drops of air fluid exchange, that's when the flap may move. So what I do is I do about 95% air fluid exchange first, then come out and wait for 1 minute, relax my shoulder and hands, and then I go in, and my flap is temporal, usually I use a temporal, so I tilt the eye nasally so that the remainder fluid, actually the current is from temporal to nasal, and then remove the remaining, so that the flow of the fluid actually pushes the flap on the hole and go from that direction. So that way, the last few drops actually is my friend and stop being my enemy by the direction of the flow.
Great. Try keep being seated and having a massage for the minute. You know, it works as well. Safe going out, please.
Right. Jerzy, you're a good friend. I know you are a good surgeon, but I'm not convinced with the inverted flap technique need for all the cases. Now, a couple of comments. David Martin's cases. David, there are a lot of surgeons in the world who can achieve similar success or better success in the macular holes you showed on the video. So I think it's overkill. We don't need scarring in the macular hole for improvement of vision. We need photoreceptors, and we can't bring the photoreceptors. So that's one thing. Second is like Alexandro's case, where you can see that if somebody else is seeing the patient and they will think that there is a preretinal fibrosis. So I'm saying in a joking way that somebody needs to remove that preretinal fibrosis because you can see the ILM flap. So the simple comment is, I think it's overkill. Good idea to begin with, but I don't think we need for all the cases. Maybe for the really large, 800,000 micron, bigger than that, maybe a tiny autologous flap coming on that. I haven't tried, but I've seen some of the videos, which was interesting. And most important thing, we don't have comparative data, really good comparative data for the same situation. So perhaps you guys are underestimating your skills and not allowing just to follow the basic principle. For me, best wound construction to avoid any possible future leak for the gas, good vitrectomy to have good gas fill, staining with triamcinolone all the time to remain the last possible layer of the posterior hyaloid, and then staining the vitro-macular interface and remove the ILM. And obviously waiting, having some patients go at the macular hole a couple of times and remove the, not at the RP, but at the edge or maybe optic nerve head and remove the fluid, because that's aqueous, which is going back. And if you go 10 times, perhaps it will get collected. But maybe 2 to 3 times removal, that will be enough. And if you try that, you will not need inverted flap technique too much. Sorry, Jerzy.
Thank you.